Hello, and welcome to Stop Predicting Major Gifts to Start Closing Them. My name is Kevin Bauman, and I'm the Director of Philanthropic Initiatives here at Capture Higher Ed. I also have the privilege of being your host for the next half hour as we walk through major gifts today. If this is your first time tuning into an advancement webinar with Capture, please note that we are going to put as much information into the next half hour as possible. If at any point we go past a piece of information too quickly, my contact information is listed at the bottom of the screen now, and it is also included at the bottom of the screen in our final slide. Please do not hesitate to reach out for any further information if you would like to dive deeper into any of these topics, and we're not able to cover that in the presentation today. Now, because we are going to maintain our 1.5 hour timeline, we are going to jump right into our topic at hand, stop predicting major gifts to start closing them. The first point is that we're not here to tell you that you're doing it wrong. As a matter of fact, most of the metrics that we are using today have been tried and true metrics going all the way back to when I started as a student caller in the phone-a-thon back in 2001. What we're here to tell you today is that the same way that many advancement offices are looking at the phone-a-thon and trying to decide, is this a point in time where we should be using this solicitation channel, that the world has evolved and that advancement practices are moving forward. And so we're not here to tell you that you're doing it wrong, but we are here to tell you that the world is changing. And along with those changes, there have been changes in donor expectations, which we'll cover in just a minute. There have also been changes in the advancement toolkit. And that's what we're really here to talk about today, is those changes in advancement toolkits and getting us away from the predictive analytics that we've been relying on since I was a student caller in 2001, and talking about how institutions across the country are now leveraging marketing automation to better understand which constituents are actively looking into gifts today. So before we jump in, yesterday there was a wonderful Golden Globes presentation that inspired a couple of slides. Maybe you've seen this performance in your own advancement office, a major gift officer sitting at their desk making calls. Then enter stage left, the vice president enters standing at the office door and says, we need you to make more outreach. I'm sure many of you know what the next reply is. I need better prospects is a common reply from our gift officer. But then the voice down the hall says, after a third cup of coffee, our prospect researcher replies, have you called the prospects that I've already assigned to you? If that performance is familiar to you in your advancement office today, you're in a good place. Or maybe this one, a vice president standing at the front of the room saying fiscal year end is just 4 months away. We'll need to generate $700,000 before then. Maybe you're the vice president standing at the front of the room, or maybe you're the gift officer saying, where does she think that I have an extra $700,000 in my portfolio in the next 4 months? Or maybe you're the gift officer sitting next to that gift officer thinking the same thing. Or you're one of the gift officers in the room who all go and say, if I had $700,000 in my portfolio, I would go on and close it today. Or maybe you are the prospect researcher who's sitting there saying, where am I going to find $700,000 of new assignments that are going to close in 4 months? If this is a familiar conversation to you, then we're glad you're here. Whether you're standing at the front of the room or whether you're sitting in one of these chairs, we're very excited to talk about how marketing automation is helping advancement offices across the country answer these very questions. So where are we going to go over the next 30 minutes? First place we're going to go is today's myriad of scores. There are scores for everything in our industry. We are going to abbreviate many of them. Many of you use them every single day. But we're then also going to talk about why outreach is still over 90% inefficient despite these scores. For those of you who are tracking this metric on campus today, we would love your feedback. And if you're not, please don't hesitate to reach out. We'll be happy to share our research with you. From there, we're going to go on to what question are we really trying to answer with these myriad of scores? We'll start wrapping up with behavioral intelligence and marketing automation, if those are new terms to anyone. We will be defining those and talking about how institutions are leveraging them. We'll be talking about how these two aspects start to help across the advancement office to answer the question we're really asking today. And then finally, we're going to wrap up with social media and digital ads. Many of you are starting to really bolster social media outreach and digital ad work. And those leads are actually already being driven to your website. So many of you already have these leads just simply waiting for you on your website today. And then we're going to wrap up with what users of marketing automation are actually saying and the results that they're seeing. So that's our agenda for the next 30 minutes. Let's start off with today's myriad of scores. And the existing scoring models, we're going to introduce you to two prospects, Kathy and Frank and Felicia. Now, these may be discovery calls number 94 and 95, number 110 and 111, but these are unassigned major gift prospects who are in your discovery pools. And what do we know about these prospects based on existing scoring metrics? Well, we know that they have a wealth rating. That wealth rating can be 25,000 or 50,000, they're relatively close. We know that they have a gift range score. In this case, those are close. They have a propensity score. They have a plan giving likelihood score. And then we did a little LinkedIn research to better understand what their job title is. And so with this information, we now have all kinds of scores about wealth and propensity and all of those sorts of things. And I'm going to guess that if we asked everybody on the presentation today, which prospect you should start reaching out to first, we would have 100 different answers as to why one of these prospects is better. And that really goes to show the challenge of today's scoring methods is that it doesn't answer the question that we're trying to answer today, which is which prospect should I really be reaching out to? These are just two prospects that get lost in blind discovery calls. And the challenge with the metrics that we have in the advancement industry today is that as we looked at gift officer outreach, this is actually a study that we did with a major state institution in the Midwest. We looked at gift officer outreach based on existing scoring metrics and based on existing assignments from prospect research. And we went to see how much gift officer outreach was actually focused on an alum who took a visit. And we all love our metrics that go up and to the right, but unfortunately, even with today's scoring metrics, our chart goes down and to the left. You'll notice 76% of gift officer outreach was focused on an alum who was non-responsive. Another 15% was focused on an alum who outright declined the visit. And only 9% of gift officer outreach was actually focused on an alum who took a visit. And this underlines the challenges of today is that with all of the existing scoring metrics combined, what we're currently seeing in the industry is 91% gift officer inefficiency. Because at the end of the day, bringing together all of these scores, we're still not answering the fundamental question of what we really want to know, which is who I should call to close a gift this year. You see, all of the metrics that we just talked about were predicting behavior sometime in the future. But for many of us, we have goals that we need to hit this year. And so the fundamental question of who should I call this year comes down to gift cycles. Now, it may be that Frank and Felicia and Kathy, who you met previously, look very similar with existing metrics. But what if we could tell you that one of those prospects was going to spend 4 months in discovery and one of those prospects was going to spend two? And one of those prospects was going to take another 3.5 months in cultivation, where one of those prospects was only going to take a month and a half. And the other prospect was going to spend 3.5 more months in solicitation, where the other prospect was going to spend half of that. And then by the time that we delivered a proposal, one prospect is still going to need to talk to their tax accountant and to their attorney, where the other prospect is already prepared. You see, what we're talking about today is how do we identify constituents who are further down their decision-making path? And so they shorten their gift cycle. And we're not trying to predict an action sometime in the future, but we're starting to act on the intelligence to know who is looking into a gift today. So what if you actually knew that between Frank and Felicia and Kathy, what if you actually knew that Kathy was not only wealth rated to $25,000, and clearly she wasn't assigned, but she actually visited the website 32 times in the last 12 months. And while she was on the website, she looked into an infrastructure project on campus. You would then know that you are talking to a highly engaged, unassigned major gift prospect who on her own is actually looking into infrastructure projects on campus. Now you'll notice in the timeline on the right-hand side of the screen, Kathy's been very active on the website. So don't let me let it get lost that in September, Kathy researched infrastructure projects on campus. Now she's done a lot of things. She's a highly engaged major gift prospect, but you'll notice she's actively looking into gifts on the institution's website. And it's this information that helps us understand that if we're going to reach out to one of these two prospects, because we can't reach out to every prospect every year, it's going to be Kathy that has the shorter gift cycle. And we can start to talk about Kathy closing her gift this year rather than sometime in the future. What you've just seen is an example of behavioral intelligence. Understanding the behaviors of visitors on your institution's existing website, and then providing the intelligence to the team to be able to prioritize relationships where our constituent base is prioritizing us. Behavioral intelligence is built on marketing automation. If this is your first time hearing about marketing automation, we'll give you a quick example. Marketing automation, again, is understanding the behaviors of visitors to your website. Now, what are those behaviors? Well, as it turns out, we've been training alumni to come to our website for years now. Every e-solicitation that we send out, every email newsletter, every e-communication that we send out from the institution, and we tell somebody to read about the athletics team, or we tell somebody to read about this alum success story. Where does that success story actually live when I click that link? Well, it lives on the website. And as we start to put more and more social media out there, and we're boosting posts about the same topics, and I click through that link in social media, where does that article live? Well, it lives on the website. And as more and more institutions get into digital ads, which we'll cover later in the presentation, more and more institutions get into digital ads that talk about delivering the solicitation in real time, not on the institution's website, but out on a number of websites where alumni are actually engaging today. Those digital ads, when I click through those digital ads, it drives me to the website. And then finally, we also have alumni who organically come to the website. As a matter of fact, if you were going to figure out if the basketball team won last night, where's the first place that you would go? You would go to the website. And so what you have is the website being a central digital asset and marketing automation being the ability to track every visitor coming in and actively engaging the institution on the website, understanding their engagement, and then building behavioral intelligence. So what does this actually look like? Now, you saw the ability to prioritize Kathy in a major gift environment. I'm also going to introduce you to Amy in our plan giving environment. Now, Amy is probably not jumping off the screen at you as somebody that we should be reaching out to about a plan gift. She's relatively young, hasn't given in a while, and she hasn't given a lot. And for those reasons, she has never been assigned. But when we look at her activity on the plan giving site, you'll notice that in July, she went to the plan giving website where she actually read a donor testimonial. Not necessarily life-changing information, but it certainly gets us on, gets her on our radar. And then over the next week and a half, she went to the alumni website where she looked into a scholarship. Now in Amy's case, this is actually a study abroad scholarship. And you'll notice that she looked into it three different times, showing us that she really is digging deeper on this study abroad scholarship. And then by the following month, she organically returns to the plan giving website where she downloads multiple resources about leaving the institution in her estate plans. And so what you've just seen there is the ability to take a constituent who ordinarily wouldn't be on our radar. And we now know that Amy is having a plan giving consideration. That plan giving consideration likely includes us. That plan giving consideration likely includes a study abroad scholarship. And this would be a meaningful time for us to reach out on the donor's timeframe, not necessarily simply because they are blind discovery call number 94 or number 95, and I just completed blind discovery call number 92 or 93. And so behavioral intelligence and marketing automation is allowing institutions across the country to take those predictive analytics and move away from predicting major and planned gifts and simply observe them, because constituents are on your website in the way that you have taught them for years to come to the website using your e-communications, your social media strategies, your digital ads, and all of the great information that you have on your website that alumni visit organically. You've been training them to leverage your website. Now, when we add behavioral intelligence and marketing automation, it's not only the ability to understand behaviors on your website, but it's also the ability to then trigger custom communication to turn your website visitors into leads for your major or plan giving team. So what does that look like in real time? Well, because marketing automation has the ability to track alumni on every single page of your institution's website, you can actually know where alumni spend their time. The chart that you see on your screen actually shows you that at the very top, alumni spend the majority of their time on the athletics website. that may or may not come as a surprise to many of you. From there, it's the main.edu. The reality is alumni have a relationship with your institution, and that oftentimes is checking in on the professor that they love on the College of Business website, or it's checking into the entrepreneurship team on the entrepreneurship page. As a matter of fact, if you brought together all of the activity on all of the advancement pages, it's really only 20% of all alumni activity. Now, if you were looking at the very bottom of this of the chart of where alumni spend their time on your website, you'll notice that most constituents do not visit the plan giving website. Now, no matter how beautiful your plan giving website is, and no matter how much effort you put into it, the simple truth is that the data shows that most constituents will not visit your plan giving website. This is not our effort to say, give up your plan giving website. We just got done showing the insights that come from visitors to your plan giving website who are leveraging very important resources. And the return on investment from that website is very high. So this is not our effort to say that we should stop doing that. But what if you could take that message, and when alumni engage the institution on the website, because you know they're alumni, what if you could take that message and you could display it where alumni would actually see it? And so maybe it's an alum who's on the main.edu and you want to put up a digital form using marketing automation to ask them if they're considering leaving the institution in their estate plans. Or maybe it's an alum that goes to the athletics website, and because it's an alum, you want to put up that same form and ask them if they're considering leaving the institution in their website. Or maybe it's an alum that comes to the alumni website. And you've got the idea here. Because we know it's an alum, you want to put up a digital form to ask those constituents if they're considering leaving the institution in their website. What we've just done is we have shown how marketing automation can help deliver the plan giving message that only one half of 1% of all alumni would ever see on their own, where alumni will actually see it today. And what you would get if you walk down this path, we'll show you some results in just a few minutes, but what you would get if you walk down this path is, instead of blind outreach that's over 90% inefficient, you would come into the office with a list of constituents who have actually raised their hand and asked for you to reach out about transformative gifts on campus. And what we're doing here is marketing automation is the ability to match up our team members directly with constituents who are actively considering transformative gifts to the institution. And because our marketing automation practices are now engaging constituents where they are today, we can turn that information over to the team, allowing them to reach out directly and say, in this case, that top line there for Matt, who is wealth rated to $100,000 and requested information about starting the estate planning process and estate planning strategies. Our team members can now say, Matt, this is Kevin calling from campus. Wanted to follow up on your request for more information about estate planning strategies and starting the estate planning conversation. It's these strategies where we are shortening the gift cycle, because in a traditional environment that a gift cycle might take 12 to 18 months, the front end of our gift cycle is heavily focused on discovery and cultivation. And even in the previous example, which we showed you earlier, where you see on that bottom line, we're actually able to shorten the gift cycle by using the tracking aspect of marketing automation. Digital ads now give us the information that we need to eliminate the discovery and cultivation timeframe and reach out directly to constituents who have actively requested information about transformative gifts on campus and take us directly to solicitation and closing the gifts. For those of you that are tuning in today, wondering how we are going to meet our metrics before the end of the fiscal year, these are the type of leads that are moving to proposal in a matter of weeks rather than the traditional giving cycle of months or years. Now, the good news about marketing automation is that it integrates very well with your digital channels. Now, many of you are starting to engage with digital ads. Social media is a very common place for us to have been for the last 3 years, but more and more institutions are really doing a lot with digital ads. For those of you that are unfamiliar with digital ads, Capture has a wonderful introduction for digital ad strategies for advancement, which you can find in the same place that you found this webinar. It also includes examples of how institutions are leveraging those four different digital ad strategies, one of which you see on your screen. And the digital ad strategy that you see on your screen is actually from the Alzheimer's Association. It's a real example of a digital ad where I visited their website and they were able to keep that message in front of me. Clicking through that message drives me back to their website to learn more about their initiatives. And it's through those digital ads that more institutions are driving traffic to their website, in addition to all of the great email communication pieces that your team is already sending out. And it's this traffic through digital ads, through email communications, through social media, and through digital ads that are driving a consistent stream of visitors to your website and ultimately identifying new, highly engaged, unassigned major and planned giving prospects who are actively being reported out to the institution to drive that new stream of donors. And so for those of you who may be wondering, well, great, Kevin, we've got a number of new leads that we're providing, but what happens after alumni are actually contacted from the advancement office? Well, here's what institutions are saying as they start to go fundraising where the donors are with marketing automation. As a private liberal arts college that generated 60 new endowment requests and planned giving requests in the last 7 months. In contacting their team, they reported back that they're already reaching out to constituents that have made a planned gift and they're just waiting on the major gift portion of a blended gift to come in. So they're starting to close these gifts those leads came in less than 7 months. Another major state institution who narrowed 100,000 top prospects to the top 2% looking into gifts reported back that these are exactly the leads that we need. Their team that was previously 91% inefficient in reaching out is now focusing on the top 2% of prospects who are actively looking into transformative gifts to the institution today, saying these are exactly the leads that we need. And a large state institution who generated 40 new endowment and plan giving requests in just 2 days followed up with us just a couple of days after they generated these leads to say that they already spoke to one of these prospects, and she does have a strong interest in leaving the institution in her estate plans, and that it should be a nice gift. And so as marketing automation comes into advancement offices across the country, it's really important that today's changes in the advancement toolkit are allowing us not only to talk about how do we engage constituents where they are today, but they're allowing us to strategize better in every position across the advancement office. So for those of you that find yourself sitting in the office, maybe you're standing at the front saying June 30th is 4 months away, we still need to generate $700,000. Where are we going to come up with that $700,000? Rather than having team members thinking through, where does she think I have this $700,000 of pipeline hid? You'll have team members that are raising their hand saying, I just reached out to 5 new prospects asking to talk about an endowment. And you'll have prospect researchers saying, well, we just assigned 15 new prospects who are actively looking into estate gifts. And it's by shortening the gift cycle and effectively assigning these prospects and reaching out to constituents when they want to be reached out to, that institutions are starting to stop predicting major gifts and starting to close them. And so it doesn't look like we left too much time for questions today. But as I mentioned on the final slide, my contact information is listed at the bottom. If you have a question that we were unable to answer today or to get to today, please do not hesitate to reach out to me directly. I'm happy to dive into any of the metrics that you saw here today or help explain where this information came from. With that, I want to thank you for joining Stop Predicting Major Gifts to Start Closing Them with Capture Higher Ed. My name is Kevin Bauman, and I truly appreciate your time today.